Bruno.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, we can hear you.
Ah, thank you. Okay, my talk is about linear response for spiking neuronal networks with unbounded memory. So it's a bit mathematical talk. Nevertheless, I will try to give some introduction and where I think people will be able to understand what are the main questions. And then there will be a bit of maths. And in the end, I will come also to concrete results. So I hope people will also be able to follow. I mean, those who are not familiar with this type of mathematics. It is a work which has been done in collaboration with Chilean people, Rodrigo Cofre and Ignacio Ampuero. So, sorry, here is the context. So, I'll start with a simple example. My results are not, they are more general than this simple example, but it's just to give a flavor. So assume that you have a network of neurons. So the neurons are here that correspond to the black points, and these neurons are connected together. You have excitatory reciprocal connection, which are in red, and inhibitory reciprocal connections. So we assume that this neural network has a certain dynamic. For example, it can be an integrated and fire neuronal network. And so this means that it will produce action potential or spikes. So this is what you can see here, just the dynamic of this simple model. So the question I want to ask now is, what happens if this neuron can also feel external stimulus? So here for the moment, the dynamic was stationary, but now if you have an external stimulus which is moving along this chain, you expect to have a non-stationary response, typically this one. So here you see the response of the neuron, of course, when the stimulus is going on. So before you have this stationary response, here you can see very well the effect of the stimulus, and then you return to stationarity. And here you can see the effect of inhibition, lateral inhibition, and also there is a bit of excitation in the middle. So this is a typical pattern that you can have when a non-stationary spatiotemporal stimulus is going on in the network. Now, I want to ask the following question. If I measure the correlation and first the spike rate without the stimulus, so this is a neuron index. Here I have 30 neurons in this example. I am measuring the firing rate, and it is almost constant, except at the boundary, because here I have an open boundary condition, meaning that the neuron at the boundary here has no neighbor on the right. So here, the firing rate is constant. Now, in the presence of a stimulus, I expect this firing rate to change. So here in black, you see the stimulus. In the green, you see the response of the firing rate in the presence of the stimulus. And here in orange, you see what happens when I remove to this green response the constant firing rate. So you see here that the firing rate has variation, and this variation, you can see very well, for example, here, the effect of inhibition. So a stimulus can be seen in the variation in the firing rate of neuron. Here, if you want to compute, this is an average. So if you want to compute this firing rate, you have to be careful because dynamic is non-stationary, so you cannot use time average. So you need to do sample average. Now, my question is a bit more general than that. Here, I have dealt with firing rate, but I could also consider correlations between neurons. For example, I'm considering the probability that neuron 12 is firing as time t and neuron 15 is firing as time t plus 2. So this correlation, I expect it to change as well when the stimulus is arriving in the field of this neuron. And you see here the variation of the correlation. So in general, you can ask this question for any type of observable implying the spike. So you can compute the probability that three neuron spikes or more, and you expect the stimulus to change what you get without stimulus. And this is very complex because, of course, the change will depend on the stimulus itself, but it will also depend on the interaction between neurons. So here you can start to understand that you cannot anticipate easily what is going on. So the question is indeed, Can we compute the spatiotemporal response of a neural network to a time-dependent stimulus? And in fact, we would like to infer what will be the response mathematically, knowing the stimulus and having information about the dynamics. So I'm going to present an example of where we can make this computation. And at some point, I will give a more general setting where you can make this question more general and more abstract. So this is in a paper which is under submission. So the example I'm going to give is a classical, almost classical integrate and fire neuron. So for you, maybe you know, or at least if you don't know, I'm explaining. A firing rate neuron is you have a variable which is called the membrane potential, which is evolving in time. And when it reaches a certain threshold theta, the neuron is reset to this reset value. You wait a certain time before restarting the dynamics. So here, this corresponds to what is called the refractory period. So the neuron cannot fire during this period. When the neuron fires, you record the spike here, one, and here you have zero. So here, I have been the time in this interval of duration delta. It's called binning period. So here, the time is continuous, and here the spikes are recorded along a discrete time with windows of size delta. So this is an interesting dynamics because we have continuous time for new voltage and spikes are discrete. Now, I'm going to use a bit of notations. I'm going to write the spike emitted by neuron K in the bin N by omega KN. So this is a variable between takes value zero if there is no spike and one if there is a spike. I'm considering now a spike pattern, which is a list of all spike variable at time n, so by meaning time n. So these are just zero and ones. It tells me the state of the neurons in the bin n. And I'm also considering a spike block, which are the spike pattern between m and n. So in ergodic theory, it's called a cylinder. Here, it's just a spike block, but there is a link with cylinders in ergodic theory. So here, we are looking at the spike from M to N. So now, what is the dynamic of my dynamical system? So the beginning, this term is the classical evolution. This is the conservation of charge, if you want. This is the membrane capacity of neuron K. This is the voltage. Here we have a classical conductance term with a leak conductance, reversal leak potential, and the voltage. So this is a leak current. And here we have the interaction with the other neuron of the networks. And this is made with a classical term of this type, where here we have the reversal potential of the presynaptic neuron G. So it depends on the type of neurotransmitter and receptor that you have in the network. But what is important here is the conductance, which depends on presynaptic neuron, postsynaptic neuron. It depends on time, but also, and this is very important, it depends on the spike history. So when I wrote GKG T omega, I'm considering the spike arriving before time T. Of course, it depends on the past and not on the future. So what is this object? In fact, it is constructed as follows. When you have a spike, a presynaptic spike, it induces in general a postsynaptic response in the voltage of the neuron, which has typically this shape. So now we consider that these spikes are modifying the conductance of a neuron. So each time you have a presynaptic spike, you modify the conductance and you add up the effect of all the presynaptic spike. So typically, you obtain this type of evolution for the synaptic conductance between neuron J and neuron K. So this, in fact, you can rewrite it as a function of the spike history. So you get something which depends on the spikes that has been emitted by the presynaptic neurons. So in fact, you can make this dynamic more complex. You can have, of course, a time-dependent stimulus, which depends on the neuron. And here it's a noise term, a Brownian noise term. So this is the dynamic below the threshold. So it's evolving in time. And depending on the history, when the neuron is spiking, it is reset. You register a one at that neuron, and this will modify the conductance of the neurons which are postsynaptic to that neuron. So we obtain a very complex dynamics, which is a continuous time dynamic, but which depends on an history, which is a spike history. And actually, this history can be infinite. I'm going to explain that in 1 minute. So, well, if you want, you can rewrite this equation in a more classical form. In particular, you can introduce what is called synaptic weights, and you get this system, which is a little bit simpler because it looks very much like a linear system. But in fact, it's a strange dynamical system in the sense that if you fix the history, omega before time t, you get a complete linear dynamical systems, which is easy to integrate. And this is in fact what you obtain here. You can compute the flow explicitly. And now the trick is that in fact, because the neuron is reset when you have a spike, you just need to integrate from the last time in the past where the neuron has fired. So this is the meaning of this notation. You start at time t, you go in the past and you look at the last time in the past when the neuron has fired. So if t1 is larger, you just take the integral between t1 and t. And if it is smaller, if 2k is smaller than t1, then you just integrate from the reset time. So again, this is not a classical dynamical system in the sense that it depends on an history. And in fact, this history is the voltage is integrated back to time to k, but in fact, the conductance depends on the whole history. So you get, in fact, something which depends on an infinite history. But the good news is that this history, in fact, is exponentially decaying because of that. And this is what makes all the story work. So once you run that, you can integrate, you can play with your dynamical system. You can, in fact, compute the voltage at time t, show that it depends on the spontaneous part, on the stimulus-dependent part, and on the part which depends on noise. And again, it's always conditioned upon the spike history. So for each spike history, you have a different result. And if I have question, I would like to mention that this spike history is related to symbolic coding in ergodic theory. We don't need to use that, but if people wonder, there is a relation. Okay, so there is a deterministic part and a noisy part. Okay, now I would like, the important thing is that in fact, in this spontaneous part, or which is the part without the stimulus, it is interesting to see that we have a leak part, but you have a synaptic part which depends on the interaction between neurons. So this is here that we have the network. So it depends on the synaptic white, it depends on the spike history, and it depends on the flow and also on the synaptic kernel here, which is exponentially decaying. And this is very important. So from that, in fact, we can compute the probability that, we can compute the probability to have a given spiking pattern given the past. And in fact, this is the main object I'm going to deal with. So you compute the probability of a spiking pattern at time n given the infinite spike history. And here, you can compute it explicitly depending on the parameter of the network. Now, the interesting thing is that if the memory were finite, you would have a Markov chain. And if you have a Markov chain, there is a couple of things which are known. And in fact, there is a link with what is called in statistical physics Gibbs distribution. So if all these transition probabilities are positive, you know from Perron-Frobenius theorem that there is a unique invariant ergodic distribution. And in fact, if you play a bit with that, you can show that the probability to have a spiking block at Mn is given by this equation, which is the standard Chapman-Kolmogorov equation. So you can, if you introduce the log of the probability, which is well defined because it is positive, you can write the probability to have a certain spike block as a product, as an exponential of a sum of this quantity, which is called the potential. And if you compute the conditional probability, you get just the exponential of something which in physics is called an energy. So there is a link with what physicists call Gibbs distribution in statistical physics. So there is a lot of small subtleties that I can answer if you have questions, but I just want to go through that. So these Gibbs distributions are very important in statistical physics because, of course, they can be used to found thermodynamics from microscopic dynamics. This was Boltzmann program. They also play a role. Here we can, in fact, extend this notion to spike distribution. I don't want to enter into detail, but what I want to mean is that this part is completely independent of the model I have presented before. It's a very more general setting. This Gibbs distribution appears also in ergodic theory. And now, if you want to consider a system with an infinite memory, as I was dealing before, it's called a chain with complete connection. And in fact, it's known in mathematics since this time. So it's a very old story. So if I come back to my subject, I can compute explicitly the probability to have a spike pattern given the past. And this is given by this integration I made on the dynamics. And now, I have a part which depends on the spontaneous dynamic and a part which depends on the stimulus. So here I have a non-stationary part. And the interesting thing is that given that, in fact, using a Taylor expansion to different order, and here I stay at the first order, it's possible to answer the question I was asking in the beginning. Namely, if you have a certain function of the spike train, for example, the firing rate of the correlation, you want to ask how much will it be changed if you apply the time-dependent stimulus? And we obtained an answer which is classical for physicists, at least. It's given by a convolution kernel with the stimulus. And the interesting thing is that this convolution kernel depends on the function f. It depends on the observable. So here you can compute it explicitly. I will not give all the details, but basically what is important is that it depends on the history. It depends on the observable. It depends on the network. It appears here in this series and or here in the flow. And in fact, it's a correlation function. So in physics, it is known as the fluctuation dissipation theorem, but it's quite more general here. So mathematically, you can answer the question I was asking. If you know the stimulus, if you know the dynamic, you can compute the kernel, and then you can anticipate what will be the response to a stimulus only knowing the spontaneous correlation. This is a very important result we got here. You compute the correlation without stimulus, and you're able to predict what will be the change in correlation with stimulus. This is a very deep result, which is classical in physics, but again, to my best knowledge, it has never been established for neuronal network for general observable. So I just want to finish with an example. So the main difficulty in this stuff is not to do the maths, in fact, is to do the numerical simulation, because to handle such a complex system is very hard. So I'm going to give a simpler example where we consider just a classical leaky integrate and fire model, where of course the same theory apply, but we don't have this complex dependent in the conductance. I have discretized time to binarize it. So in fact, you can make exactly the same computation and obtain a nice formula which gives you the response to the variation of the average of a certain function given correlation computed without stimulus and depending on the network effect in particular. So I don't know how many time I have, but anyway, I have finished almost. This is an example of what we can obtain. So here I'm computing the experimental response. So here it's a firing rate. I am computing the experimental response to the stimulus variation in range. And you see, in fact, different formula for the linear response that I have computed. The blue contain more terms in some expansions than the green. So you see that we are able to predict quite nicely the variation in the firing rate. Of course, it will depend on the amplitude of the stimulus. I just mentioned that we are doing linear response, meaning that we are truncating, we are neglecting higher order terms. So if you increase the amplitude of the stimulus, you start to see discrepancy, for example, here. The nice thing is that we can also, so you can obtain the as I say, it's an expansion in correlation function. So here are the correlation function. I want also to show you what we obtain if you now apply the same question to correlation. So again, we compute the probability that, so here it's the probability that neuron K minus 2 fire at time N minus 3 and that neuron KC fire at time N. So it's a kind of correlation as well. We compute how much it varies with the stimulus. And you see that the blue is experimental, and the orange is the theoretical prediction. I think there was a mismatch with the color, but anyway, this blue is experiment, and here are the predictions. And again, you see that it's not too bad, except if you increase the amplitude of the stimulus. So in fact, you can see how much increasing the amplitude induces a discrepancy with what you expect. I'm not commenting on that. I just would like to conclude. So what we have been able to show is something that somewhat is known, but here we have make it mathematically concrete. You can express the response to a stimulus just knowing the correlation of spontaneous dynamics. So this is a very strong result. So the linear response is characterized by a convolution kernel, and in fact, which is related somewhat to the notion of Gibbs distribution. So when you have a model, in this example I gave, you can determine easily what is this conditional probability, which log is called the Gibbs potential. From data, it's quite more tricky. And this is something that we are also doing from here. But in general, the potential is shaped from dynamics. And in contrast to statistical physics, I don't know if there are physicists in the audience, but in physics, we have an idea of what should be the form of the potential from thermodynamics. In neuroscience, we have absolutely no idea. So it's just like fishing. So there is some formal results like the Hammer-Speckley-Ford expansion, which allows you to find the right basis to develop this potential. But then you need to find a way to trunk a term, and it's something difficult that we are trying to base on information geometry. Okay, so there is also a question about what happens if you are considering higher order terms in the response. So in the context of hyperbolic dynamical system, David Ruel made a complete computation where you can compute the higher order terms. In our case, for the moment, we don't know how to do that. If there are people come from the field of computational neuroscience, I would like just to mention that this kernel KF is somewhat an extension of the concept of receptive field. In general, when people are computing receptive field, so they computed with the firing rate, but you can consider more general response. And I think it could give interesting hints on how a neuronal network encodes information about the stimulus with its spikes. Not only firing rate are playing a role, but also the correlation, which are not only given by the stimulus, but really by the synaptic interaction between neurons. And this is what we have shown with this result. Okay, I have finished.